Hello friends, welcome back to our channel NEET Biology Expert. I am Dr. Parveen. In this lecture series, we are studying Class 12 Biology Chapter Human Reproduction. In this particular lesson, we are going to study in detail about placenta. So what is placenta? What are the structures present in the placenta? And what are the functions of the placenta? So this is what we are going to study in detail in this particular lesson. Let's get started. So first one is, what is placenta? Placenta is a temporary structural and functional connection between the fetal and maternal circulation. So, if you see a pregnant woman, the pregnant woman has placenta. So, this is a temporary organ. That means when the baby gets delivered, so after delivery first, the baby will be delivered, followed by the placenta also gets out, removed. Okay, so that's why we call this as a temporary organ. This is not a permanent organ, this is a temporary organ. So till pregnancy it is present. So once the baby is delivered, the placenta also gets removed out of the body. Okay, so this is a temporary structural and functional connection between the mother and the fetus. That means the maternal circulation and the fetal circulation has a connection. So that connecting organ is the placenta. So it is an intimate connection between the fetus and the uterine wall of the mother in order to exchange the materials. So mother has all the nutrients. Okay, so the baby is developing. So for the baby to grow, it needs nutrition, right? So those nutrients are provided through the placenta. Okay, so it is a connection between the fetus and also the uterine wall of the mother, where the gaseous exchange, nutritional exchange, everything takes place. This placenta is present in all viviparous animals, mammals, viviparous, everything has this placenta except Prototheria. So what is Prototheria? This animal, this group of animals is called Prototheria. Now these are all extinct animals. So these are all slowly, they are vanishing. Okay, these species are very rare species. So except this Prototheria, all other viviparous animals, including humans, they have placenta. Right. So let us see about placenta. Placenta is a flattened discoidal organ. So what is mean by discoidal? Discoidal means it is like disc shape and it is flat. Okay, so look at this picture. This is a picture of the placenta. Here this red color region, completely this red color region is the placenta. So it is present in the uterus of the pregnant woman. It is not just a simple membrane. See, whenever during pregnancy or any other thing, what happens, many times some temporary membranes will be produced. Okay, so like that, this is not just a membrane. This placenta itself is an organ, but this is a temporary organ. Okay, so till she is pregnant, the placenta is there to support the developing embryo. And once pregnancy is completed, the placenta also gets expelled out of the body. But this is not just a membrane, this itself is a complete organ. Okay, so this is a discoidal organ, and in a well developed placenta, it is 500 grams in weight and it is dark reddish blue. You can say it is reddish blue in color. Okay, because it has both arteries and veins. It is dark reddish blue in color, and a fully formed placenta we can see in 11th week. So around 11th week of pregnancy, a woman will have completely or fully formed placenta in her uterus. Okay, and it remains throughout her pregnancy. And this placenta is attached to the wall of the uterus and the baby's umbilical cord. Okay, so this placenta is like in between. This is at one end, it is attached to the uterus of the mother. At the other end, this is connected to the baby through the umbilical cord. So you could see here this rod like structure. This is the umbilical cord. Okay, so let us see how the placenta is formed. So the placenta here, this is a very special organ, and this is the only one organ in the human body where it is formed of two different tissues from two different people. Okay, so it won't be present in the male, right? It is present only in the female, that too in the pregnancy period only. So here this placenta is the only organ which is formed of two groups of tissues, two different types of tissues. So one from the mother and one from the fetus. That means two different individuals. They participate and they come together and form a single organ, that is the placenta, right? So let us understand how it happens. See, we have studied previously implantation. That means after fertilization, the blastocyst is formed. Blastocyst is formed. This blastocyst, they come and gets implanted in the uterus. Okay, endometrium. So this is the structure of the blastocyst. This is a ball of cell, right? So the outer covering of the blastocyst here. This outer covering of the blastocyst is by a flat cells called trophoblast. Trophoblast cells. This is a single layer of flat cells surrounding the embryonic cells. These are the embryonic cells, okay? This trophoblast cell is very much important in the blastocyst, okay? So first this trophoblast only gets implanted on the uterus wall, okay, and it penetrates deep inside, and then again all the other parts of the cells, that means the embryonic cells, then enter followed by it, okay. So what happens here, after implantation, some finger like projections appears on the trophoblast cells of this blastocyst. They are called chorionic villi, okay. See here, if this is the embryo, the outside cells, this previously it was the trophoblast cells, okay. Now these cells, what happens once the blastocyst gets implanted, they slowly form a finger like projections like this. They appear, they grow and appear towards the uterus wall, that side. So those finger like structures are called chorionic villi. So once the finger like structure, that means the chorionic villi, are formed, they are surrounded by immediately uterine tissue and the maternal blood supply. Okay, so look at this picture here. This is the embryo, right? So here this structure, these structures, see, these finger like projections are called chorionic villi, or we call this as placental villi. Okay, so this is then surrounded by mother's tissue, uterine tissue and blood supply. Clear? Right. Now what happens? This chorionic villi and the uterus tissue, they become interdigitated. This is a very important word. Interdigitated. Okay. And they form together the placenta. That means, so look here. This is the baby's chorionic villi, finger-like projection, they extend. And on the other hand, the mother's uterine tissue also extends. Okay, so they merge together. They interdigitated. Interdigitated means we call our fingers as digits. Okay, so interdigitization. So they merge together and they form a single organ. So now this organ is called placenta. Understand? So jointly they form a structural and functional unit between the developing embryo and the mother body. So this is called placenta. So that's why I told previously, this placenta is the only organ, only one organ in a female where it is a combination of two tissues, one from the baby and another from the mother. Okay, so two different individual tissues together form this placenta. So this organ is also called as interdigitalized organ. One good example is placenta. Okay, right. Look at this picture at your left. So this is the baby developing. Okay, so here you could see here this finger like projection, this tree like projection. Okay, so this is chorionic villi. So this chorionic villi, all these regions are from the baby. Okay, that means the trophoblast forms this structure. Okay, the other end having the mother's blood supply. So both merge together and form the center part. That means these red region, this is the placenta. Clear? Okay. Now let us see this some more in detail using this picture. Okay, so this is an embryo. Okay, so this region, okay, we are talking about this region. All this region is the placenta, right? So this is just a zoom part of this. Okay, so this is the fetal end, right? So from the fetal ends, we could see here, like a finger like projection. What is this? This is the chorionic villi. Okay, chorionic villi. And now this chorionic villi, where it is merging? This is merging with the mother's blood vessels and also the uterine tissues. Okay, these are all mother's blood vessels and uterine tissues. So together, this merged area, interdigitalized area, we call this as placenta. Okay, so here is the mother end and this is the fetal end, and center part is the placental region. Clear? So in this picture, you just see here, this is the placenta. Okay, so in the placenta here, this is the mother's region, mother's end, and this is the fetal end. So together in the center, it forms the placenta. So here, this placenta is formed by two regions. So one is called fetal placenta, another is called maternal placenta. Okay, so what is this? Fetal placenta means the fetal placenta is formed by chorion, allantois, yolk sac, extra embryonic connective tissues and blood capillaries. So these all regions, they together, this structure together contribute to the fetal placenta. Okay, so look at this picture. Okay, in this picture, and this is the embryo. This is the embryo, right? So in this embryo, here present this chorion. This green color is the chorion. Okay, and all these finger like projections are the chorionic villi. This chorionic villi and allantois. This region is allantois. This region is the yolk sac. Okay, and connective tissues, blood capillaries. So these regions together contribute the fetal placental part. On the other hand, the mother has also some contribution, right? So majority of the contribution of the placenta is from the mother's side, maternal side. So this we call as maternal placenta is formed by the uterine wall, epithelium, connective tissue and blood capillaries. This region, uterine wall, this blood vessels, okay, arteries, veins and mother blood tissues. So together they contribute this thing and they form the placenta. So here the maternal placenta is rich in blood supply. So if you see this, you could understand this area has more blood supply, right? Arteries and veins are more present because all this comes from the maternal side, because the mother is only going to provide the nutrition for the baby. So the maternal blood supply is rich or high in the maternal placental region. Clear? So this is called maternal placental region, maternal placental region, and this is called fetal placental region, fetal placental region. So together it forms the placenta. Okay, here another important thing is this maternal placenta is also called as decidua. This is the biological word. Okay, so what is decidua? The other name for the maternal placenta region is called decidua, and they form the major part of the placenta, right? So look at this picture. This decidua has three important regions. Okay, so look here. This is the, what is this? This is the embryo, right? This is the embryo, and here you could see here a finger like projection. And what is this? This is the chorionic villi, finger like projections from the embryo, right? So just straightly beneath the embryo, this region of the placenta, okay, just beneath the embryo, this region is called as decidua basalis. Decidua basalis, you know, base part. So it is present in the base part of the embryo, directly connected to the uterus, uterine wall. Okay, so this part is called decidua basalis, right? And second part is called decidua parietalis. Parietal means corner. Okay, see here, this region This is also a part of the placenta only, but it is not just straightly near the embryo, it is on the sides, at these sides. So we call this part as decidua parietalis. Okay, not only that, some part of the placenta, they cover the embryo like this, a thin covering. This region is called decidua capsularis. Capsularis means covering, capsule. Okay, so the maternal placenta decidua has three regions: decidua basalis, decidua parietalis, and decidua capsularis. Okay, let us see that using this picture. Okay, so you try to identify where these regions are present. So this is the very much grown baby, right? So this region is the placenta, right? So where it is just directly attached with the uterine wall, this region is decidua basalis, decidua basalis. Okay, and here the placenta which is present at the sides, these are called decidua parietalis, parietalis, right? And there is a thin outer covering surrounding this embryo, this is called decidua capsulatus. Clear? So these are the three maternal region of the placenta. They contribute majority of the placental part. Okay, here the human placenta, we call this in some other names called hemochorion, metadiscoidal, chorioallantoic placenta. So all these names are the other names for the human placenta. So hemo means blood, so blood. Chorial, chorial means chorionic villi. Okay, so that contribution is there, no? So hence it is called hemochorion, metadiscoidal because of its shape, and chorioallantoic region is there, no? So hence it is also called as chorioallantoic placenta. So these are the other names for human placenta. Okay, fine. So let us now study the most important part, that is the functions of the placenta. So what is the functions of the placenta? What are the functions of the placenta? The first major important thing is that placenta helps in the exchange of the materials between the fetal and the maternal blood. Okay, so placenta plays a major role in the exchange of the nutrition. So you see here, the first important job of the placenta is to transport nutrition from the mother to the fetus. See, when we talk about the ovum of the human ovum, we call it as microlecithin. Why? Because it has very, very, very less yolk sac or no yolk sac at all. So what is the function of the yolk sac? The yolk sac provides nutrition for the growing embryo. For example, in case of a bird, hen, any bird you take, the yolk sac only provides nutrition. But in case of the human or mammals, this yolk sac is not there, microlecithal, because the nutrition for the growing embryo will be provided by the mother directly. Okay, so those nutrients, whatever the mother is eating, those food, those nutrients are transported through the placenta and it reaches the fetal blood circulation. Okay, so transport of the nutrition, placenta provides nutrition to the growing embryo. So this is the first important job of the placenta. And second one, they help in the exchange of the respiratory gases. See here, the baby is developing, the baby's lungs cannot directly intake oxygen or it won't respire out directly carbon dioxide. There is no direct contact with the atmospheric oxygen and carbon dioxide, right? Atmospheric gases. So those gaseous exchange takes place through mother's circulation only. Okay, so whatever oxygen the mother is inhaling, those oxygen get mixed with the blood, diffuses, and it reaches the placenta. The baby takes it. And similarly, the baby releases carbon dioxide. Those gases diffuses out. They come to the placenta and mother circulation takes it, so that the mother exhales that carbon dioxide. Understand? So these kind of gaseous exchange for that very important organ is placenta. So supply of the oxygen and also remove carbon dioxide. So these functions are carried out by the placenta. And see here, how these exchanges are taking place. This taking place through diffusion, pinocytosis. Pinocytosis is also called as cell drinking. or by the active transport. So the molecules, the gaseous exchange, nutrients exchange, so these things occurs between the maternal circulation and the fetal circulation by diffusion or through pinocytosis or through active transport method. Okay, so let us understand how this exchange between the maternal and the fetal blood circulation takes place using this picture. Okay, so see here, this is the fetal end. This is the fetal end. Okay, so here present the umbilical cord and this is the mother's end or maternal end. Okay, so here the maternal artery, it is carrying oxygen. Suppose, okay, it is carrying oxygen. The artery is carrying oxygen, and what happens? These arteries drops this oxygen in this area, in this region. Okay, so from this region, these oxygen molecules will be taken by this maternal circulation. You could see here, this is the maternal veins. Okay, they come and collect here, and these go through the umbilical cord to the baby like this. Okay, so this umbilical artery, this blue color is the umbilical artery and red color is the umbilical vein. So the umbilical vein takes this oxygen and it transports through the umbilical cord to the baby. Similarly, the baby is releasing out carbon dioxide. So what happens? The carbon dioxide comes out through this like this, and they get released out here. And they get released out. Okay, so here present maternal vein. So the maternal vein takes up the carbon dioxide and it carries this and it sends it to the major vein system and gets released out from the mother circulation. So similarly, the nutrients, everything, transport takes place. So what we should understand here is, see here, here is the maternal artery, maternal veins like this, and here is the fetal artery, fetal veins like this. You could see they don't get directly connected. Okay, it is interdigitalized, but it won't get directly mixed. That means maternal blood supply will not mixed up with the fetal blood supply. Never it happens. Okay, so whatever the oxygen, whatever the nutrients the mother's blood is carrying, it drops all this in this area, where the placenta, in the placental region. Okay, so from that area only the fetal blood circulation picks it up, fetal capillaries picks it up and transport it through the umbilical cord. Understand? So this is the placenta basical structure. So let us see the picture at your right. So what are the things that get transported from the mother? Oxygen, water, electrolytes, carbohydrates, lipids, polypeptides, amino acids, vitamins, hormones. So all these nutrients get transported from the mother to the baby. Similarly, from the baby, what are the things get transported? Waste products like carbon dioxide, water, urea, ammonia, other hormones. So these are all waste products which gets released out from the baby. So all this exchange occurs through the placenta, but it never gets directly mixed up. Okay, then the second function of the placenta is it removes the nitrogenous and metabolic wastes of the fetus. So this is very, very important. See, for example, we pass urine. Urine is our nitrogenous waste product, right? Metabolic waste product. Similarly, the fetus also has waste products, right? So those waste products like ammonia and other nitrogenous substances, those substances are released out through the placenta only, okay? And it gets mixed with the mother blood circulation, and mother blood circulation releases it out, okay? So all the nitrogenous wastes, metabolic wastes of the fetus released in the mother by the diffusion through the placenta, right? And the another important function of the placenta is it provides immunity. See, this baby is growing, the baby completely, its immune system might not have been developed, so its immunity is very, very less, but it needs some immunity, right? So those immunity are provided by antibodies. See, mother, our body produces five types of antibodies: IgA, IgG, IgM, IgD and IgE. This we called as GAMD. Okay, five types of antibodies. So of these five types, only IgG antibodies have the ability to cross the placenta. Okay, so only IgG antibodies. IgG antibody shape is like this. It is a mono antibody. It is like Y shape. So it could able to cross the placenta and provide immunity to the growing fetus. So we call this as a passive active immunity. This is very important. Which antibody cross the placenta? IgG immunoglobulin cross the placenta. Okay, right. So here we understood that placenta provides nutrition, placenta provides immunity, placenta removes metabolic waste products, like this many things. So here none of the things crosses the placenta from the mother directly. All the nutrition, waste products are get diffused only. Okay, but only antibody IgG directly crosses the placenta. Another important thing here is some harmful drugs, some chemicals and some viruses, they have the ability to directly cross the placenta and affect the growing fetus. Okay, this is an important thing we should understand. See, some harmful drugs like additive drugs. Additive drugs means alcohol from this beer, wine, rum, all this drinks, okay, alcohols, and then nicotine from this cigarette, okay, and cocaine, all this additive drugs, you know, heroin, cocaine. So all these drugs have the capability to directly cross the placenta. So these chemicals cross the placenta and it causes deformity in the growing fetus. So fetus will not completely develop, or there may be some structural deformity. So this process is called as deformation, and those substances are called as teratogens. Teratogens means some chemicals or additive drugs which causes fetal deformity. They are called teratogens. Okay, and the another thing is some viruses. Majority of the viruses, we could say, because viruses are very much a microscopic, right? So the viruses, they could able to cross the placenta. So if the mother is infected, if the mother has any viral infection during her pregnancy time, she has the chance, like those viruses could cross the placenta and cause the same infection in the growing embryo also. Okay, sometimes maybe the mother may be just a carrier, okay, maybe not get infected, but if she carries the virus in her body, it could also able to transport or cross the placenta and cause infection in the growing embryo. Okay, so such diseases which are caused by the viruses by crossing the placenta, they are called transplacental diseases. Understand, they cross the placenta, these viruses cross the placenta and causes infection in the growing embryo. This is also called as congenital diseases or transplacental diseases. Okay, so example, or cytomegalovirus, herpes virus, rubella, HIV AIDS virus, parvovirus is the smallest virus which could cause the infection, varicella virus, chickenpox virus and enteroviruses. So these are the viruses which could able to cause infection in the growing embryo. Okay, and the other important function of the placenta, which we could understand very much important for the exam point of view, is the hormones secretion. So the placenta plays a major role in the hormonal secretion. They form two important steroid hormones. Steroid means cholesterol molecule containing hormone. Estradiol and progesterone. Estradiol means they are of the same category of estrogen. Okay, so estrogen, progesterone are produced by placenta, and two protein hormones called human chorionic gonadotropin, shortly HCG, or and human placental somatomammotropin, HCS. The other name for HCS is human placental lactogen, HPL. Both are same. Somatomammotropin or placental lactogen, both hormone is the same. This is easy to remember, HPL. Okay, so estradiol and progesterone are the cholesterol hormones, steroid hormones produced by the placenta. HCG and HPL are the protein hormones produced by the placenta. Here we should understand that This hormone HCG is very, very important. This HCG hormone is initially produced by chorionic villi. You know the chorionic villi, finger-like projection. So if the embryo is growing like this, this finger-like projection is called chorionic villi, right? So this chorionic villi produces initially during the first trimester of pregnancy. That means 1 to 3 months of pregnancy, HCG hormones are, the levels are high in the pregnant women. Okay, so these hormones are only detected in the pregnancy testing kits. We have this ready-made fast pregnancy testing kits, right? Like this. So in this strip, what is coated? The strip contains anti-HCG coated in the tissue. Okay, so this HCG hormone level is high in the blood in the female, and it also get released in the urine during the first trimester of the pregnancy. So we have to take few drops of the urine and put it here. This HCG and anti-HCG forms some reactions like agglutination and forms a band. So if the band appears, this is a positive test result. Okay, so the pregnancy test kits, they detect the HCG level in the urine. So HCG level increases in the first trimester and then it decreases. Okay, clear? Fine. Next, what are the other hormones produced by the placenta? So let us learn this. So by the end of the first trimester, that means during the first to third month, this is called first trimester, HCG hormone level is high. Okay, from the fourth to sixth month, that is the second trimester, now the woman will have more progesterone. More progesterone is produced. Okay, this progesterone is produced by placenta, right? See, initially when the ovulation occurs, so after ovulation, okay, the mature graafian follicle ruptures and after that it becomes corpus luteum. Once the ovulation finishes, the ruptured graafian follicle becomes corpus luteum. The function of the corpus luteum is to produce progesterone. This progesterone is called as pregnancy hormone. Progesterone is called as pregnancy hormones, okay? Because during that time, suppose if implantation occurs or if fertilization and implantation occurs, this progesterone plays a major role. So during the earlier stages, corpus luteum produces this progesterone. Now after implantation, once the baby starts growing, embryo is growing, now who is producing progesterone? Placenta. Placenta is producing the progesterone. So what is the function of this hormone? This protects the growing embryo. It prevents the abortion, okay, and growth of the mammary glands, that means the secondary sexual character, development of the breast, enlargement of the breast. So like this, the secondary sexual characters are enhanced by this progesterone, okay. And apart from that, during pregnancy, a woman will have high level of cortisol, prolactin, thyroxine. So these hormones, estrogen, progesterone, cortisol, prolactin, thyroxine, these hormones levels are several folds increase. The amount is 4 times, 5 times more in a pregnant woman. Okay, so why? Because they are essential for the fetus growth, metabolic changes in the mother, and to maintain the pregnancy. So for all these things, these hormones are very, very essential. Okay, right. Here, the another important thing which we should learn is another hormone called relaxin. Relaxin, the name itself shows relaxation, relaxin, okay. So, this relaxin hormone is produced by ovary, very important. When, during the last phase of the pregnancy, that means in the 9 and a half months period, when the baby is fully grown and ready for parturition, ready for delivery, so this hormone is released. This relaxin plays a major role in the delivery, that is parturition. Okay, so HCG, HPL and relaxin, these three hormones are produced only during pregnancy. In none other time a woman produces these hormones. Clear? Fine. So here let us understand some another important thing called umbilical cord. What is umbilical cord? The placenta is connected to the embryo through an umbilical cord, which helps in the transport of the substances to and from the embryo. See, this is a baby just now delivered, okay, and this is the placenta, right? So here there is a connection between the baby and the umbilical cord. Sorry, the baby and the placenta. This connection is called umbilical cord. Right? So what is umbilical cord? The fetus is connected to the placenta by the umbilical cord. Okay? So what is the length of this umbilical cord? Around 12 to 24 inches in length, long. So this is a baby. Okay, you see, after delivery, this thing, this cable like structure is the umbilical cord. We used to cut it and put a clip. Okay, and this umbilical cord and the placenta, both we used to dispose. Right, so this is the umbilical cord. This is a connection to the placenta. This umbilical cord is formed of three blood vessels. It has two small arteries which carries the blood towards the placenta, that means from the fetus to the placenta, and one vein which returns the blood to the fetus. Okay, see here, this red region are the two arteries present in the umbilical cord and one vein. So these three blood vessels forms the umbilical cord. They are present here. Clear? Okay. Now, previously we used to dispose, after the baby is born, we used to dispose the umbilical cord and the placenta. Now it is not like that. We are now storing the umbilical cord blood. So that is called cord blood. The umbilical cord blood that remains in the umbilical cord and the placenta after delivery. So it is a process of collecting the cord blood, extracting and cryogenetically preserving it for its stem cells. See, when the baby is delivered, we are cutting the cord, right? So that time some blood will released out. So those blood is full of stem cells, right? So when we study about blastocyst structure, the blastocyst, okay, the outer cells of the blastocyst are called trophoblast cells, and the trophoblast is a single layer of cells, okay, and inner layer of cells, some 10 to 25 cells are present. These are called embryonic cells. Embryonic cells, these embryonic cells only grow and become the other parts of the embryo. So these embryonic cells are actually stem cells. So similarly, such stem cells are present in the cord blood and also in the placental blood immediately after delivery. Okay, now what we are doing, we are collecting this blood, preserving this blood cryogenetically, means we are keeping this under frozen condition, minus 80 degree cryogenetic. Okay, so preserving this stem cells. Why? Because suppose in future, if the baby has any problem, like any diseases like cancer, particularly blood cancer, leukemia, or certain other type of cancer, sickle cell anemia, or any other metabolic disorders, we use this stem cells as stem cell therapy. Stem cell therapy. Okay, so not only for the baby, the baby's close relatives like father, mother, or her brothers, sisters, like that, very much blood related persons, relatives. So if they have also like cancer or any other problem, these baby's stored stem cells can be used for the treatment or therapeutic purposes. Okay, so this is called as cord blood or cord blood banking. So see how we do this. So after delivery, immediately this is the umbilical cord. Okay, this is cut and the blood from this cord is sucked. Okay, and it is stored. See here, a barcode is given, right? So it is stored, cryogenetically preserved. This we can keep it for any number of years. Okay, and like how we store our jewels, our documents in the bank lockeries, so like that we have bank. So such bank is called cord blood bank. Cord blood bank. We store such blood in the blood bank, cord blood bank, not just blood bank. Okay, and if anybody has the need, for example, even for the baby, same baby or their family members, or they can be a donor also after matching. Okay, so this cord blood can be used for the stem cell therapy. Okay, and to store this blood in India, a few private blood banks are there. And first in India, a government blood bank is there, cord blood bank, that is called in Kolkata. In 2001, it was first started in association with American Association of Blood Bank, AABB. Right? Understand? Okay, this is all about cord blood and placenta. So I hope you understand this lecture. Our next lecture will be about extra embryonic membrane. So if you like this lecture, don't forget to like, share and subscribe to our channel, Meet Biology Expert. Meet you in another lecture. Till then, take care.